Okay, if not, we move on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Shaintani Ghosh. She is also a final year BSc student at Ranaghat College, affiliated to Kalyani University. She has attended the MTTS Level O program in 2021. She is going to speak on Fermat's Little Theorem. So over to you, Shaintani. Please unmute and...
Hello everyone, I'm Shaintani Ghosh and today I will be solving a problem using number theory. And while doing that, we might stumble upon some interesting conclusions. So let's see, okay? Let's begin. So my session plan today includes a problem to solve, which I will introduce shortly. And I will give you a brief introduction to the concept of congruence. I'll define a prime number and then we will speak about some conclusions. So now imagine that a jewelry shop owner has to make necklaces out of beads, okay? And it happens that the owner has A colored beads available. So consider that this is a basket of A colored beads and she has to make a necklace out of these beads, which are available in A different colors. Now, she did a survey to find out what kind of necklaces would sell the most. And the surveyor set out some criteria for her. So the first criteria is that the necklace has to have N number of beads, okay? And the second criteria is that the necklace has to be multicolored. Now, from this data, the owner wants to know how many distinct necklaces she can actually make. So let's find that out. So before working with variables like A and N, I will take some examples and we will see how many distinct necklaces are actually can actually be made and why am I talking about distinct necklaces? Okay, so I've first taken this example for A equals to 2 and P equals to 3 or N equals to 3, whatever. Sorry. First, if you take, how can you make a necklace, right? You take a string, you put some beads in that string, and then you join the ends of the string to form this necklace, right? So she has two colors available, say red and blue. So first she takes one red bead, she takes another red bead, and then she takes another blue bead. And then she joins the end of the necklace, and this necklace is formed, right? Let's move on to the second one. She takes one red bead, she takes another blue bead and another blue bead. And she joins the ends of these two to form this necklace. Now this necklace and this necklace are distinct, so no issues. Now, she takes another necklace, another string, and she puts first a red bead, then a blue bead, and then another red bead. And she joins them and this necklace is formed. Observe. If you rotate this necklace, you will actually form this necklace. Now for a jewelry shop owner, isn't it redundant to have two similar necklaces which you can form by rotation? I really want you to closely observe this fact. Again, there are other possibilities as well. So she takes a blue bead, she takes a red bead, and then a blue bead in a string and joins the ends and she forms this necklace. Does this necklace seem familiar to you? Well, yeah. See, if you rotate this one, you will actually get this one again. Possibility number five. She takes a blue bead, she takes a red bead, and she takes another red bead, and she joins the ends, and she gets this necklace, which you have already seen actually, because this one, right? And then there's possibility number six, which will ultimately give us this necklace again. So observe, we got exactly two distinct kind of necklace and exactly three, one, two, and three gave this one pattern and another three gave another pattern. The reason I did not consider all reds and all blue was because the criteria was given. No, no monocolored necklaces. The necklaces has to be multicolored, otherwise they won't sell, guys. So let's take another example. A equals to 3 and P equals to 4. So our criteria is multicolored. So let's take two colors first and see what happens. So the combinations are red, blue, red, white, and white, blue. I have already marked it out what will happen if I take two colors, right? So these four strings will give this pattern. These four strings will give this pattern. These four will give this pattern. And these two will give this pattern. Okay. So how? Because if you rotate them, you will get each of the strings giving this pattern. Observe, each set has four. Each set has four. This set has two strings. Keep that in mind. So the next combination would be red and white in a similar manner. I'm not going into further details. Next pattern will be blue and white in a similar manner. And I have pointed out why I said keep the two strings in mind. Why these, I have exactly four strings giving this pattern, and why I have two strings giving this pattern. See, you have repeated units, two repeated units. So the cyclicity, or if I put them again, like if I put this unit after this unit, I will again get this unit, right? So it does not make a difference. That is exactly why we are getting only two strings giving this one pattern. Next slide. So we are done with two colors. Now we have multicolored. So we have three colors. So we will form necklaces where all the three colors are present. So our combinations will be first red, blue, and white, then either red or blue or white. So first taking two reds, one white, and one blue. These are all the possible combinations, right? So I have already computed it for you, but you can take some time and observe what is actually going on, right? So if you each of these strings will give this pattern. Similarly, for two blue, one white, and one red. And similarly, for two whites, one red, and one blue. Now, why am I speaking about these necklaces, and why am I regrouping them? That is something I really want you guys to soak in. See, here I had my n is equal to 3, and I got, and these number of distinct necklaces were equally, like equal number of strings gave a distinct pattern. Equal number of strings gave a distinct pattern when n was equal to 3 or p was equal to 3. Like it is prime. But when it's not a prime number, it's a composite number, you don't get it. You don't get that same pattern because of this thing, repeated units of length 2. Now keep this in mind, take some time and try to soak it in. Like, why is there a difference? Why this thing might happen? Okay. So let's move on to the next topic, congruence. So congruence, I'll just give the definition of congruence. So let n be a fixed positive integer. Two integers a and b are said to be congruent modulo n, symbolized by this, if n divides the difference a minus b. So if n divides a minus b, we say a is congruent to b modulo n. Here are a few examples. Very evident why 12 is congruent to 3 mod n, 2 is congruent to minus 4 mod n, and you can actually find out why 2 is not congruent to 4 mod 6. Now, I will give you two properties. There are many to consider, but I have just written here two. So let n be of greater than 1 be fixed and a, b, c be arbitrary integers. My claim is if a is congruent to b mod n, then a plus c is congruent to b plus c mod n. How? The proof is very simple. If a is congruent to b mod n, this implies n divides a minus b. Now, a plus c minus b plus c is equal to a minus b. And we know n divides this number. So n divides this a plus c minus of b plus c. Or we can say a plus c is congruent to b plus c mod n. Similarly, my claim is if a is congruent to b mod n, then ac is congruent to bc mod n. How? AC minus BC is equal to C into A minus B. So thus, C divides A minus B as N is congruent to A mod B, as A is congruent to B mod N, and so N divides A minus B. So N divides C into A minus B. This implies N divides AC minus BC, or we can say AC is congruent to BC mod N. I introduce these two properties because they might come in handy. Okay, now this is the definition of prime numbers, which is, I believe, nothing new. Okay, I'll move on. Now, why I spoke about congruences and in the middle of a problem on strings and necklace. So, what I want to ask is, can the number of strings giving one pattern be related to congruences? Remember, I said that when it's a prime number, equal number of strings give a distinct pattern. So we will just first observe this thing for prime numbers. So we saw that when we don't have repeated units, equal number of strings give each pattern. A kind of number we certainly cannot divide are primes. Like primes have only two divisors, right? One and p. We cannot divide primes into two halves or three parts or four parts like that. Anyway. So a string of p, which is a prime number of beads, will always have a cycle length of p, because anything less than p, it's not, you cannot divide it, right? So it will always have a cycle length of p. We cannot have this repeated unit. Now the total possibilities, we have a number of a colored beads, and we have p number of beads to put in one necklace. So a to the power p strings are possible, right? We exclude monocolored strings because that's what the surveyor told us. So we will be working with a to the power p minus a strings. We observe that these strings are equally divided, and exactly p strings will give one pattern, right? Because the cyclicity of p of a string containing p number of beads, where p is a prime, is p. So p divides a to the power p minus a. Okay, so p divides a to the power p minus a, where a is any integer. Now that sounds a little bit unique, right? So let's see. Is there a pattern? Can we actually find a pattern? So we have taken a prime p, there is 5. And so 13 is congruent to 8 mod 5. 13 square is congruent to 4 mod 5. You can continue and observe 13 to the power 5 is congruent to 13 mod 5, or 5 divides 13 to the power 5 minus 13. Right? That's what we saw, right? P is a prime, then P divides A to the power P minus A. Similarly, for 14, observe 14 to the power 5 is congruent to 14 mod 5. And 15 to the power 5 is actually congruent to 15 mod 5. It will ultimately turn to 0 because 15 is divisible by 5, but 15 is also divisible by 5, right? So anyway, so it seems like there might be a pattern here. So let's see. So I've made a claim that a to the power p is congruent to 1 mod p, where p is a prime and p does not divide a. Because if p divides a, it's congruent to 0, and a is also congruent to 0. You can see that. So let's consider if p is not. AP does not divide A. So let's prove it, okay? So let P be a prime and P does not divide A. Consider the first P minus 1 positive multiples of A, that is A, 2A, 3A, up to P minus 1, A. None of these integers is congruent modulo P to any other, nor is congruent to 0. Why? Suppose if it's not, and I have R less than S less than P, such that RA is congruent to SA mod P. Then P divides RA minus SA, right? by our definition of congruences, implies P divides A into R minus S. But we know P does not divide A and P is a prime. So P must divide R minus S, implies R minus S is equal to zero because we have taken this to be less than P, right? Which is not possible because we already said R is less than S. So this thing, what I just said, is true. Therefore, the previous set of integers must be congruent modulo P to 1, 2, 3 up to P minus 1 taken in some order. Like, I'm not saying that it will be A is congruent to 1 mod P, but it can be, it will be this set of integers in some order. Now, multiplying these, okay? So, multiplying A into 2, A into 3 into P minus 1 congruent to A using the property AC is congruent to BC mod N, we have this multiple, this expression congruent to this expression mod P. Or A to the power P minus 1 is congruent to P minus 1 factorial. A to the power P minus 1 into P minus 1 factorial is congruent to P minus 1 factorial mod P. Now, P certainly does not divide P minus 1 factorial. So we conclude using a similar kind of argument like before that A to the power P minus 1 is congruent to 1 mod P. Now we have stumbled upon something that I actually wanted to speak about today, which is Fermat's Little Theorem, which says, yes.
You have 5 more minutes.
Okay. So we actually stumble upon Fermat's Little Theorem, which says, suppose P be a prime and P does not divide A, then A to the power P minus 1 is congruent to 1 mod P. This can be extended to suppose P be a prime, then A to the power P is congruent to A mod P by multiplying A on both sides, and we can exclude this condition. Okay, so Fermat's Little Theorem has some applications. So it was initially thought, could it be a test for primality? Like if a number is prime, can we judge it by this? You can actually read about it, and I will not explain, but it actually fails. It fails for 341. The first number it fails for is 341. The converse is not true. And also, Fermat's Little Theorem was later extended by Euler, and he found Euler's theorem, which says if A and N are integers such that N is greater than 1 and GCD of A and N is equal to 1, then A to the power phi N, where phi N is Euler's phi function, is congruent to 1 mod N. So what is Euler's phi function? Euler's phi function is the number of positive integers not exceeding than N that are relatively prime to N. And Fermat's Little Theorem can actually be thought of as a special case of Euler's theorem, as for prime P, phi of P is equal to P minus 1. Okay. And with this, the story continues because it has some applications which you can read about from online or from the sources that I'm about to mention. So my references for this presentation were from Elementary Number Theory by David M. Burton. And I also took some reading material from Art of Problem Solving. Thank you.
Thank you, Shantani, for motivating Fermat's Little Theorem by a combinatorics problem.